Hello everyone, today is 27th of August. My name is Sahil and welcome to the newspaper analysis. Guys, first of all, apologies for the yesterday, as yesterday I was suffering from fever because of my vaccination, so I was not able to stream the video for yesterday. Apologies for that. Now guys, beginning up with the today's newspaper analysis. Friends, into the today's newspaper analysis, we will be taking up all the relevant articles from the Hindu newspaper, as well as we will be taking up the articles from the Indian Express, the explained section. Now, before starting up, first of all, let's see the overview of the articles that we are going to take up today. First of all, if we go to the explained section, the first article onto the explained section, it is talking about the SEBI regulation that has come with respect to providing the stock options to the employees. However, with respect to the UPSC, the substance has not been there into this particular article, not that much important. Then guys, the below article, it talks about the ISIS chapter into the Afghanistan. Now you might be knowing that an attack has happened into the Kabul. So we will be covering this particular element into the article onto the Kabul attacks. Then guys, the below article, it is talking about the annual Malabar exercise which has begun. So we will see the issues with respect to the Malabar, basic details with respect to this particular thing we will be seeing up. Then moving to the Hindu newspaper. So this is the page number one of the Hindu newspaper. And guys, here the first article, it talks about the twin blast that has happened into the Kabul. So with respect to the Kabul attacks, we will be seeing it, what has happened. Then below article, it talks about the Supreme Court direction that it has given for taking the immediate relief for the children who had become orphaned due to the COVID-19. So into this particular direction, we will be seeing the background, that what are the steps, what are the impacts onto the children and all such kind of things. Then below moving guys, here we can see that the Delhi High Court has given an important judgment with respect to the right to privacy. So we will see that what has happened. Then guys, here we can see that inaccessible UIDAI system leaves Aadhaar users in lurch. So this article is talking about the non-functionality onto the UIDAI platform, which is there due to a technical glitch that is going on. Guys, a similar technical glitch is also going on to the income tax portal. So we are moving into the direction of a digital India, but still the technicalities and all such kind of things are to be fixed. However, with respect to UPSC, nothing much important has been there. Then guys, other articles are basically the political news. You don't need to go into that. Then guys, further moving, the next page is the city section. Now into the city section, guys, this particular first article, the DU comes under fire for dropping text by Dalit writers. Now this article is providing that how the text that was written by two of the Dalit authors, they have been dropped by the Delhi University from its new curriculum. And it is being criticized that the Delhi universities is sidelining the Dalit authors, and particularly the text which have shown the atrocities onto the downtrodden sections, the Delhi universities dropping it. So such kind of criticism had come, but the university has justified it that we are not doing such kind of things. So guys, these kind of events portray that onto the social front many a times, the governments, many a times the institutions, they go with into the direction of mainstreaming the entire community, and into that the sensitivities are often dropped. Then guys, further moving on. Now, onto the page number 3, there is nothing with respect to the UPSC, the rising number of cases, the availability of the beds, etc. has been there, nothing important. Then guys, further moving on. Now here we can see that this article, Punjab government, it is giving the incentives for the stubble burning. So with respect to the winter pollution that happens, we will see that how these particular steps will be helping. Then below article, it is talking about the Samar Lake, and the Samar Lake happens to be an important geographical location. We will be discussing it again. Then further moving on, guys, here into this particular page, again, the breakthrough infections, etc. has been mentioned. Nothing very much important with respect to the UPSC. Then we come to the editorial page. Now guys, the first article, finding India's voice on Afghanistan. Now it is talking that how India needs to engage with the Afghanistan even when the Taliban has taken over. Now guys, onto the Afghanistan, I think we had covered more than 20 articles into the past few days, and nothing different into this particular article is there. Moreover, now I believe that we have even more stuff that even we can write the essay. You don't need to see everyday developments that are going on. Then the below article, it is talking about covering the gaps into the game of data. We will be seeing that how the data-based policies we are coming out with, but still there are some of the problems. We will be covering it elaborately. Then guys, this particular article talks about the school reopening, as many of the states are going forward with it. Then the below article is talking about the asset monetization pipeline. Then, guys, the next article onto the page, it is talking that whether the first past the poll system has polarized the Indian politics, we will be seeing that what has happened. Then the below article, it is talking about the vulture conservation, because guys, now the vulture awareness day is coming, we will be discussing this entire article. Then moving on to the next page, so this first article, it talks about the drone rules that have now been liberalized, so we will see that what these drone rules are and how they will be helping. Then further moving on, guys, then we see that the other articles are basically the political issues which have been there. Fine, nothing very much important. We will be moving to the next page. Now on to the next page, we see that the India's policy onto the Afghanistan has been discussed. So we will be covering this particular article. Then the Congress's Parivartan Yatra, nothing important. Then guys, the below article, it is talking about the Supreme Court, which has now decided to hear a particular petition with respect to banning the MPs and MLA for the entire lifetime. We'll see this thing. Then further moving on, guys, again, the article with respect to the Delhi University dropping the text from Dalit writers has been mentioned. Then this particular below article, it is talking about the Indian investment into the Maldives. We will see all its implication and what this entire particular project is. Then guys, the other articles are not very much important with respect to the UPSC examination. Further moving on, onto the world page, guys, the entire page is filled with the attacks that had happened into the Kabul, onto that particular thing. The different expressions are coming from the different world leaders. So that particular thing has been provided here. Then guys, onto the business page. Now, the first article, few takers seen for debt recast 2.0, it is talking that the reserve, basically, into the recent few months, the resolution framework 2.0 was announced, into which it was provided that the people who have taken the loans, they can recast their loans if they are not having an ability to pay them back. However, much of the people have not adopted them. So just this thing has been provided here. Then the other articles are not very much important. So that is all about the overview of the today's newspaper. And now guys, let's discuss all these articles one by one. Now, first of all, starting up with the today's GS quote. So today we will be taking a quote from the Theodore Roosevelt. So Theodore Roosevelt says that a great democracy has got to be progressive. Otherwise, or it will soon cease to be a great or a democracy. Now a great democracy's power comes from being progressive, and the progressive here means progressive in terms of accommodating the diversity, progressive in terms of accommodating the dissent, as well as in bringing the ideas of modernity even when the mainstream society might not be liking it. So this is the parameter of a progressive society, and a democracy can truly be a democracy if it will be progressive. So guys, into this particular direction, all the democracies, the leaders need to see that whether they are following the idea of progressive democracy or not. Now this particular thing also becomes very much relevant into the context of India, because guys, we have seen that many of the progressive ideas such as the tolerating the dissent, they had not been taken up considerably. Moreover, with respect to giving the rights to the minorities, propagating the idea of fraternity on all such kind of fronts, also many a times question have been raised. So on to this particular direction, we needed to utterly think. Guys, we can utilize this idea into the GS paper number 2, questions related to the Indian democracy, as well as into the topic related to the into the essays, we can also utilize such kind of an idea. That is all. And now let's take up the first article. Now guys, the first article, here we have taken the articles from the Hindu newspaper as well as the Indian Express newspaper, and here we will be seeing very briefly some of the evolving situation into the Afghanistan with respect to the terrorist organizations that are playing there. Now guys, on to this particular line, you don't need to go too much into the hairline details, because that is not very much required for the UPSC, but you need to have some of the ground information onto that particular thing. Now, what has happened? First of all, the twin blast have happened into the Afghanistan outside the Kabul airport. Now, into this particular direction, first of all, the Taliban is not involved here, and Taliban has condemned these attacks that had happened. Now, the question comes, first of all, that who had taken the responsibility of these blasts? So guys, the responsibility has been taken up by the ISKP, that is the Islamic State Khorasan province. Now guys, the ISKP, it is a terrorist organization which is aligned to the ISIS. Fine. Now if we see the situation that is evolving into the Afghanistan, so for that particular thing guys, I need to tell you some of the background. Listen this particular background very carefully. See, there is one organization that is the TTP, which is called as the Tehreek-e-Taliban Pakistan. Now the TTP, this organization is a terrorist organization and it basically follows the ideology of Al-Qaeda, and its stated motto is that they want to remove the Pakistani government. They are against the Pakistani government. So this TTP is having this particular kind of ideology. Now guys, around the year 2014, what happened? The TTP, it was engaged by the Pakistani army that why you are against us, let's come together and let's sort out some kind of peace. Now when the TTP started to engage with the Pakistani army, this particular thing was not taken in a very good gesture, and some of the fighters out of the TTP, they got separated from the TTP, and these fighters, they started to give their allegiance to the ISIS. Fine. And guys, many of these fighters, now they are operating into the Afghanistan under the name of ISKP. It means that this is the ISIS branch into the Afghanistan. So basically, who are these people? These are the breakaway sections from the Tehreek-e-Taliban Pakistan. And over the last few and this ISKP was finally formed in 2014, and now guys, they have taken allegiance from many of the organizations such as the Lashkar-e-Jangvi Al-Alami, Lashkar-e-Islam, fine, Islamic Movement of Uzbekistan, Uyghur Muslims, they have also taken a support, and as well as within the Taliban that is now ruling into the Afghanistan, there are many of the rebels. From there also, they have taken up a support. So this ISKP, basically, it is following the ideology of the ISIS. Now, ISIS and the Taliban, they are not having the very good relations. Basically, ISIS is even more hardcore in terms of imposition of Sharia law. Now, the Taliban, which has come, and the Taliban, which is calling itself as the Taliban 2.0, the ISIS says that they are nothing but a ploy of the USA, and they will not be even be invoking the Sharia law as they had promised. So therefore, in order to bring Taliban in line, the ISIS might have supported the ISKP, who had sponsored the attacks into this particular region. Now guys, when we talk about the ISKP, or simply you can call it as the ISIS branch of Afghanistan, in 2020 also they had carried an attack onto a Gurdwara into the Kabul, where large number of people died, as well as they have also carried the suicide bombings again into one of a hospital into the Kabul. So basically, they are more hardliners, and now in order to destabilize even the Afghanistan that is under the Taliban, the ISIS is doing this particular kind of thing. Now, all these particular thing is pointing towards a very fundamental aspect, and this fundamental aspect is this, that the Afghanistan is in our neighborhood, and into this particular capacity, different terrorist organizations that are consolidating into the Afghanistan and trying to create the destability, that will number one be having an implication onto the humanitarian concern, number two, it will be having an implication onto the regional stability, and the spillover effects will be coming into the India, particularly into the Jammu and Kashmir. Number three, it will basically be eroding the whatever peace prospects we might be having. It will be eroding that particular thing. And guys, what will happen? Even the Afghanistan might become a problematic situation. It might develop a kind of a proxy ground for different kind of terrorist organizations. Fine. So into this particular thing, such kind of development we needed to see. Now, when we talk about the ISKP or the ISIS chapter into the Afghanistan, particularly there is one positive development that has happened, that since 2014, it has basically become a kind of a weak organization. Around 2016, it was at its peak when it was having around 8,500 fighters. Now, it has reduced considerably in 2019 and 20. But still, guys, it has adopted a new strategy, that is of the suicide attacks. And into this particular thing, it might again and again be coming with such kind of things. So, guys, that is all about this particular article. I hope you have understood it. So, just this particular kind of cocktail that is emerging, you need to have a kind of a little bit idea on it. That is all, and now we'll be moving to the next article. Now, this particular article, it has been taken up from the Indian Express Explained section, and it is talking about the annual Malabar exercise of the Quad that is going on. First of all, understanding the context. Now, why is the Quad? It means the Quadrilateral Security Dialogue, and the Quadrilateral Security Dialogue, it is between four countries, that is the USA, then there is the Australia, then there is Japan and the India. Now what has happened? The navies of these four countries, that is the USA, Australia, Japan, and India, they have initiated their annual naval exercise, and this the name of this annual naval exercise is the Malabar. Now, this particular exercise's 25th edition is now going on, and this 25th edition has started up onto the coast of Guam into the Pacific Ocean. So this is that presently why this thing has come into the news. Now, guys, when we talk about the Malabar, we can call it as a multilateral war gaming naval exercise. Now, when we talk about the genesis of the Malabar exercise, originally it was not between the four countries. It got started as a bilateral exercise between the USA and India. Fine, it got started in 1992. Then it was conducted in 1995. Then it got conducted into the 1996. However, guys, after this, India conducted the nuclear test, and because of this thing, there were the Western countries which basically was not very happy with nuclear attack, and therefore a particular few years, this Malabar exercise at that point of time, which was going between the India and USA, it got stopped. However, after 2002, again the Malabar exercise between the India and USA got started. Now, when we talk about the India and USA, basically expansion of the Malabar happened after 2007, and after 2007, the Japan and Australia, they participated. Firstly, the Japan and Australia participated in 2007, but their participation was not very much regular. And into this direction, erratically, they have participated. Clear? Guys, from 2008 onwards itself, the Australia did not participated. Fine. Now, when we see, Japan joined as a regular annual participant in 2014, and Australia had joined as a regular annual participant from 2020. And guys, in 2020, if you have followed our newspaper analysis, at that point of time, it was being said that the Quadrilateral Security Dialogue, which is a grouping of the four countries, it is becoming a kind of a military alliance. Why it was being said? Because guys, these four countries were not holding a kind of a military exercise, but after the joining of Australia in 2020 into the Malabar, the same four countries were there into the Malabar, the same four countries were into the Quad. So it was said that the militarization of Quad has happened after the Australia had joined the Malabar exercise, because the four countries are into a military alliance also. The four countries are also forming a kind of a security dialogue. So the some of the basic concepts, guys, again I will be recalling it just into the one line. The Malabar exercise, originally it was a bilateral exercise, not a multilateral exercise. The bilateral exercise between the India and USA. Secondly, earlier it was an erratic exercise. Fine, it between India and USA annually it was not going on. However, the multilateral format has been achieved in a regular manner after the 2014, when the Japan became an annual participant, and in 2020 when the Australia became an annual participant. Now, when we talk about the Malabar 2020, which is going to be held here, it will be a complex exercise which will include many of the things. It will include the anti-surface, anti-air, and anti-submarine warfare drills. Here, the four navies will be coming together, will be sharing the technical know-how, will be sharing the practices, will be exchanging the information on all these particular aspects, as well as the tactical exercises will also be carried. Now, when we talk about the 2020 Malabar exercise that had happened, it had happened into a non-contact format. And in 2021 also, the COVID-appropriate behavior will be followed. Now, the purpose of both the things, that is the Malabar as well as the Quad, is that they are oriented against the China, and basically China is the glue that is binding all these four countries. It has been said that the expansionist policy of the China into the Indo-Pacific is a concern for the democratic world, and the responsible democratic countries such as the USA, Japan, China, and Australia, they are making a diamond of democracies, and by this diamond of democracies, they will resist the China. Now, guys, this word diamond of democracies becomes very much important, because Shinzo Abe, fine, he was the I will write Shinzo Abe, he was the brain, he was the one who propounded with this Quad, and he said that the four countries, they resemble a diamond of democracy, which is against the China. So guys, please use these particular kind of phrases into your answers. So that is all about this. Nothing much more relevant apart from this has been there into this entire article. And now we will be moving to the next article. Now, guys, this particular article, it has been taken up from the Hindu newspaper. No, first of all, this article here, just a one-liner concept has been there, but very expansively, we will be seeing all the things which have been there. Now, the article provides that the Supreme Court, it had just given a kind of a direction to the center government that the PM CARES fund that you are having, in which a large sum of money was collected, can you use it immediately to help the children who had become orphaned due to the COVID-19? Now, into this particular direction, it has been said that you need to come out with the modalities that how immediately or into an urgent manner we can implement it. So just that kind of thing has been provided into this article. Now, guys, we will be seeing it into a very comprehensive manner. Now, first of all, when we talk about the COVID-19, it has been a kind of an existential crisis. And into this existential crisis, a large number of people, they have lost their livelihood. Some of the children, they have lost their parents. Now, first of all, according to the two of the sources, now the first source is the Bal Swaraj portal. Now, the Bal Swaraj portal is actually maintained by the NCPCR, that is the National Commission for the Protection of the Child Rights. According to this Bal Swaraj portal, thousands of the children had lost their parents because of the COVID-19. One specific number I am not giving you deliberately here, because guys, still this particular portal is being revised, and whatever number we will take here, it will be getting revised in few coming days. So just we can give a reference that according to the Bal Swaraj portal of the NCPCR, more than basically the thousands of the children, they have lost their parents. And the second data that we can take is from the Lancet. Now, the Lancet is one of the most reputed health journal, and according to the Lancet, it has been said that 1.19 lakh children have lost their primary caregivers due to the COVID-19. So around a lakh of the children, they have lost their parents. Now, when this particular thing was going on, the center government said that okay, we will be helping these children. And around a couple of months back, the central government had come out with the comprehensive financial aid package for the children who became orphaned during the COVID-19. Now, guys, this particular thing was there a couple of months back, and into this particular financial package, the central government provided that they will be provided the support. For example, number one, it was provided that the students who have lost their parents, they can be enrolled into the Kendriya Vidyalayas or even into the private school, and the government will take care of their expenses. Now, see, many of the children, they were all earlier studying into the private school, but now their parents have died, no can pay their fees. So government said, okay, we will pay their fees and they can continue their studies. Then secondly, it was provided that the students who are between the age of 11 to 18 years, they can be enrolled into the Sainik Vidyalayas or even into the Navodaya Vidyalayas. So this thing was also there. Then third, it was provided that the health insurance cover of 5 lakh rupees under the Ayushman Bharat Abhiyan. 5 lakh rupees health cover under Ayushman Bharat Abhiyan will also be provided to the children who had become orphan. Then next, it was provided that a 10 lakh rupees corpus will be created for every child. A 10 lakh rupees type of corpus will be there, and the child can withdraw that 10 lakh rupees after he will attain the age of 23 years. However, once he had attained the age of 18 years, some of the monthly stipend also he can withdraw from that 10 lakh rupees, which he can use for his education, buying the stationery, buying the books, etc. So guys, all these kind of reforms were announced by the central government under the comprehensive fiscal aid package for the children orphaned during the pandemic. Now, at that point of time, the government said that all the money that has to be paid for meeting all these particular things, like creating the 10 lakh rupees corpus, we will be taking the money out of the PM CARES fund. Now, this particular thing, guys, we have seen earlier also. Okay, you said this particular thing, but up till now, no modalities have been there. And actually, onto the ground, the children have not been given any kind of benefit. And because of this particular thing, guys, now the Supreme Court is asking the center government that immediately you need to come out with the guidelines, immediately you need to come out with the modalities that how these children will be helped. Now, guys, I believe that this particular news might be making much more sense. Further, when we talk about, guys, With respect to the immediate relief, it is to be provided to them because the children, they face different kind of threats into the present time. Number one, there is a threat that they might be pushed into the child labor. Number two threat is that there might be the sexual exploitation of these particular children and they might be pushed into a flesh trade. And according to the NCPCR, it has expressed a considerable fear that they might be pushed into a sex trade. Then the next fear that comes here is that psychological threat. Now, the psychological threat might restrict their entire lifelong development prospects. And guys, you need to remember that India always says that we will enjoy the demographic dividend. And in order to enjoy the demographic dividend, we need our working population, our young population to be resilient. How they will be resilient if they will be facing such kind of threats? So into this particular direction also, helping them immediately becomes a very much important priority. Moreover, in India, we follow the welfarist model of state, and into the welfarist model of state, helping such kind of sections become a kind of a priority. So therefore, urgently they are needed to be acted, and the center government needs to finalize the modality as soon as possible. Now guys, I hope that it is making even more sense. So that is all about this particular article, and now guys, we will be moving to the next article. And guys, this article is highly relevant for your GS paper number 2, social justice issues related to the children, their education. Now moving to the next article. Now, this particular article, guys, taken again from the Hindu newspaper, it will be important for our GS paper number 2 under the topic related to the rights, right? Now, what has happened here? First of all, before going into this particular article, I would like to tell you some of the background information. Guys, over the last few months, we have taken up multiple times the articles that the people are approaching the judiciary and they are asking the right to be forgotten. We have seen that earlier, one of the actress, he approached to the judiciary. Then there was some of the businessmen, they approached to the judiciary and they are asking all of them the right to be forgotten. And they say that under the right to privacy that has already been recognized by the Supreme Court, the right to be forgotten needs to be there. First of all, guys, when we talk about the right to privacy, now this particular right to privacy was given, it was recognized by the Supreme Court into the Puttaswamy case. Into the Puttaswamy case, it was said that the right to privacy is intrinsic to the article number 21 of the Indian Constitution and the citizens should not be denied this right to privacy. Now, further, under the right to privacy, guys, what happened? There was one of a committee that was constituted by the government, that is the B.N. Shri Krishna Committee. Now, the B.N. Shri Krishna Committee, actually, it was constituted that, okay, the Supreme Court has recognized the right to privacy. So, we need to come out with a law also. And under the law, we need to protect the privacy of the citizens. We need to protect the data by which the privacy of the citizens can be compromised. And the B.N. Shri Krishna Committee was asked that, okay, you tell us that what type of law we need to come out with so that the privacy and the data of the citizens can be safeguarded. Now, the B.N. Shri Krishna Committee gave many of the recommendations, and out of that particular recommendation, one of the recommendation that it gave was the right to forget. Now, into the right to forget, it was said that the people need to be given the entire authority over their data, over the information that is there onto the internet. Sometimes the people might not want that whatever information about them is there onto the internet, then there needs to be some kind of provision that they can remove that information from the internet. Now, guys, after this particular background, now we will be coming to the present news. So now what has happened? You know that today anybody can upload any information about any person onto the YouTube, onto the Google, onto the social media. Sometimes people don't like that particular information which is there. And now they are going to the judiciary. They are saying that the right to be forgotten needs to be given as a part of the right to privacy. And wherever the information is there which they don't want, it needs to be striked off. Now, into the present case, what has happened? One of the actress has approached the Delhi High Court and has asked that some of the videos are circulating onto the YouTube. These videos are needed to be removed because I want to take my this right to be forgotten. And the Delhi High Court has provided that such kind of right to be forgotten needs to be given to the actor, and whatever information or the videos are circulating, they are needed to be removed. So into this particular article, what are the key message that we are getting? The key message that we are getting is that, guys, number one, the right to privacy was recognized by the Supreme Court, and now under this particular right to privacy, even the scope is being widened. For example, the right to be forgotten has now been implicitly recognized by the Delhi High Court, and this particular thing we can see under the topic of expansion of the fundamental rights for the citizens. Is it clear? So guys, I hope that it is now making much more sense. Just I will again put it into 15 seconds that what we have learned. Number one development that has happened is the right to privacy that was recognized. Number two development, it is being said that as a right to privacy, the right to the forget also should be given. Now this particular right was recognized first time by the B.N. Shri Krishna committee, which was actually constituted to provide for the data privacy bill. Now this particular bill is already under the parliament. And now what has happened, the Delhi High Court has recognized this right to be forgotten and has directed the platform such as the YouTube that they need to remove the information when the people don't want it. So this is the evolution of right to privacy that is going on into the India. So that is all about this particular article, friends. And now we will be moving to the next article. Now, this particular article taken up from the Hindu newspaper, and guys, into this particular article, a Punjab government's initiative has been provided where they are working in order to reduce the instances of the stubble burning into the fields. Now, first of all, when we talk about the stubble burning becomes a problem when basically the farmers, they harvest their basically paddy. Okay, the farmers, they harvest their paddy around the month of the September and October, and after the paddy harvest, what they need to do, they need to go for planting their rabi crops, particularly the wheat, and for sowing the wheat around the month of the October and November. What they do in order to save the time, whatever the paddy stubble which was remained into the forest, they burn it. Fine. Now guys, first of all, the window of growing the next crop of wheat after the harvesting of paddy, this particular window is very much small, and if that particular window will not be efficiently utilized, then the rabi crop or the wheat crop that they will be growing, it will not be very much good. So in order to save the time, what they do, whatever the stubble was left behind, they just go and burn it, and it creates the problem of winter pollution into the entire North India, particularly into the Delhi. And it has been directed by the Supreme Court as well as the National Green Tribunal that the state needs to take some of the efforts in order to reduce this particular pollution into this particular direction. Guys, if you are following our newspaper, just 2 days back we have seen that even the Delhi government has started the smog tower into the Delhi. Now what Punjab government is doing, Punjab government will provide the incentive to the industries. Fine. Now, what type of incentives are being provided? See, there are two types of incentives that are to be provided. Number one, the fiscal incentives. Now, into the fiscal incentives, it has been said that if the basically it has been provided that the 25 crore rupees will be provided to the 50 existing industries if they use the paddy straw as a fuel into their boilers. Now guys, the industries such as the sugar mills, pulp industries, paper mill, they have a very big boilers, and for the boilers they need the fuel. It has been said that rather than using another type of fuel, you just use this particular paddy stubble which is there, and for that the 25 crore rupee incentive has been given. Now what will happen, as they might be getting the incentive, obviously the industries will make the effort, they will go to the farmer, they will collect their particular stubble. They might also be giving in turn the money to the farmers. So guys, here the farmer is happy, the industry is happy, and the problem of stubble burning will also be reduced. Number two, it has been provided that there will be also the non-fiscal incentives. Non-fiscal incentive is that there will be the availability of panchayat land for the industries for the storage of the paddy straw. Fine. If you want, basically, obviously there will be the large paddy straw which will be generated. You cannot use the entire paddy straw in one day. For storing them, you will be provided the land at the panchayat, so you can store it there. So such kind of incentive has also been there. It has also been provided that the balers will also be made available. Now guys, what are the balers? Baler is nothing but it is a machine which just creates the stubble into a kind of a square kind of blocks. It create the straws into them, so basically the transportation of straw becomes, or the stubble becomes, easy. So such balers will also be provided. Fine. So this is the entire financial and the non-financial incentives that are being provided by the Punjab government, and it becomes important because, guys, it is a positive step in order to incentivize the industries that you go and you procure the stubble, you use stubble into your own industries, fine, and into this particular direction, a win-win situation will be created. Now, how it will be helping into the stubble, how it will be helping, because, guys, the industries will already be using some kind of fuel, now just they will replace that fuel with the stubble. So at the pollution which was going earlier, it will remain same. So that is all about this particular article. And into your answers, what are the initiatives taken? You just give it as a case study. So that is all. Now we'll be moving to the next article. Now, this particular article taken up from the Hindu newspaper, and guys, it is talking about the Sambar Lake, which it has been provided that it immediately needs a faster restoration. Now, first of all, taking up some of the basic concepts associated with the Sambar Lake. Guys, when we talk about the Sambar Lake, it is situated into the Rajasthan, around the city, near the city of Jaipur. Now, first of all, when we talk about, by the way, guys, it is having much of a distance, but in terms of vicinity, it is around Jaipur, so we use it. Now, Sambar, it is the country's largest inland saline water lake. Fine. And number one, it is contributing large into the salt production into the country. Nearly 9% of the country's salt production, it comes from the Sambar, and majority of salt production for the Rajasthan particularly, it is coming from the Sambar Lake. Now, it also has an ecological importance because every year migratory birds as far as Siberia, they are coming into the Sambar Lake, and it has also been designated as a Ramsar wetland site. Now, when we talk about the Sambar Lake, basically the water from six of the rivers, it is discharged into the Sambar, and these six rivers are Mantha River, Rupangad River, Khari River, Khandela, Medtha River, and Samud River. So these six rivers, they are discharging the water into the Sambar. Now, when we talk about the lake, it has been said that it is constantly shrinking and the degradation of soil and water quality is going on. And because of this degradation and the shrinking size, the migratory birds, their population has declined into this particular region. Moreover, it has been provided that if we calculate the value of this particular Sambar Lake, then more than $300 million of ecological value is being provided by the Sambar Lake, and its decline will be having a large number of economical, ecological implications onto the Rajasthan as well as onto the India. Now, when we talk about the Sambar Lake, guys, in 2019, more than 20,000 of the birds and these 20,000 birds belonging to 10 of the species, they died onto the Sambar, and onto the entire world, the Sambar Lake was making the headline. Now, when we talk about this 2019 incident, why these large number of birds died? They died because of the avian botulism. Now, guys, when we talk about the avian botulism, what it is a neuromuscular illness which is caused by a toxin, and this toxin is caused by a bacterial strain called as the Clostridium botulinum. Now, because of this particular bacterial strain, they died. It affected the nervous system of the birds and the coordination between their wings, legs, it got broken and they died. Now, it has been said that now 30% of the Sambar Lake's area, it has been lost to mining and other such kind of activities. Now, the mining of the salt is going on and the illegal salt pan encroachment has happened. And over the last few years, the considerable portion of the Sambar Lake, it has got shrunk. And if immediately the efforts will not be taken, then guys, the Sambar Lake will go beyond the restoration and it will have the environment and ecological, it will be causing such kind of disaster. Now, when we talk about the sustainable developmental goals, into the sustainable developmental goals, basically a specific mandate has been there to preserve the ecology, and into this particular direction, immediate steps are needed to be taken. So guys, that is all what has been provided, and nothing apart from this particular thing. And you need to remember all such kind of information, because guys, many a times onto particularly the locations which are the Ramsar sites, the question has been asked. So onto that particular line, all these details that we have discussed, you need to keep it into your mind. Now, that is all about this particular article, guys. And now we will be moving to the next article. Now, this particular article, again taken up from the Hindu newspaper, and guys, it is talking about the issues with respect to the data. Now, first of all, Guys, when we talk about the data, you might be remembering that a few days back we have discussed one particular article onto the data, that is the no data policy of the government. Now, when we talk about the no data policy, it was said that whenever you go to the government for asking any particular kind of data, government simply says that we don't have data. They don't have data onto the number of people who died, they don't have data with respect to the poverty and many of such kind of things. They don't have any data. So it has been provided that not government is only following this particular no data policy, rather whatever data actually they are having onto that also government is not utilizing it very much effectively. It has been provided that first of all, today around the world, basically the buzzword is the evidence-based policy making or the data-based policy making. What earlier used to happen? Earlier, you were just making the policies, you were implementing the policies, but you were not knowing that what benefit that particular policy is making onto the ground. But now, with the coming of technology, such kind of thing has changed, and around the world, they are going with the data-based decisions. They take a decision, they evaluate it that, okay, by the data, whether that particular decision or policy was having any benefit or not. If it is having benefit, it will be continued. If it is not having benefit, it will be discontinued. So the data-based decisions or data-based policy making is a thing that is being followed. And by this data-based policy making, what we can address? We can address the inter and intra-district inequalities. Now, why inequalities are there? Obviously, because some of the areas are getting much, some areas are getting less. Now, guys, we can identify the schemes which had made the considerable positive impact, and we can promote them into the low, into the districts which are not having the good indicators, and we can bring them also at par with the developed districts. So basically, the data-based policies can help a large number of things. Now it is provided that actually the data-based policy making or data-based governance relies onto the reliable, rigorous, and validated data. You need to have a validated data. Now we are collecting the data, but the data is not validated into the India. How it is not validated? Guys, see, you might be knowing that at the level of panchayat, at the level of block, large number of data is being collected. For example, at the level of a panchayat, it is being said that, okay, we created 100 man hours, we gave the employment under the MG NREGA, for example, to how many people? We gave the employment under the MG NREGA to the 50 people. Fine. Or they said that, okay, under this XYZ scheme, we gave the benefit to the 100 people. Now the data is generated that, okay, these many people are getting the benefit, but you never validate that particular data onto the ground level that whether actually the benefit it had reached to the people or not. So therefore, because of the data validation, many a times we assume that actually the scheme is successful, but in reality it might not be successful. All the money that the government is giving, it might be taken up as a part of a corruption. So basically, validation of data, number one, needs to be a very important thing that should be taken up into the India. You just not believe the data, you validate the data. Second thing that has been provided here is that, guys, with respect to the data interpretation also, we need to change our approach. Now, when we talk about the data interpretation, it has been said that many a times, not a presence of no data is taken as a good thing. Now, what is this presence of no data being taken as a good thing? You just see this thing. When we talk about presently into the times of COVID-19, there are many of the states into the South India who are having a large number of cases, they are registering large number of cases. However, when we talk about the states into the North India, particularly states as Bihar, fine, there they don't show any number of COVID, they don't show much large number of COVID cases. So we cannot believe that into the North, if the data for the COVID-19 cases is not coming, the North is performing good. And at the same time, we cannot also say that if into the South, particularly the states such as the Kerala, if large number of COVID-19 cases are coming, they are not performing good. Fine. Basically, the availability of data into the South could be because of the consciousness into the people, because of the vigilance of the state to collect the data. Into the state such as Bihar, when the COVID-19 cases are not being reported, it doesn't mean that the COVID is not there. Rather, it is because of the fact that the agencies are not collecting the data. So, with respect to the data interpretation, you need to focus. Now, guys, there could be other examples also. For example, you can take the example of the police. Now, the police atrocities, particularly if we take. Now, there are some of the states where the cases of the police atrocities are more. For example, into one of the state, the cases of police atrocities which have been registered, they are 100 cases. In some other state, there are just 10 cases of the police atrocities onto the people. Now, whether you will assume that the state A is better or whether the state B is better. Now, if we see just numerically, we can see that the state B is better because here just 10 cases have come, whereas into the state A, there are the 100 cases that has come. But such kind of interpretation might be wrong because into the state A, 100 cases are coming because people might be confident that if they have been given some kind of a bad treatment, they can go fearlessly to the enforcement agencies, they will get the justice, they have a trust into the state. Whereas into the state B, there might be a case that people are so fearful by the police that they are not having any courage to go to any kind of enforcement agencies, they are not having any courage that they are not having actually any trust that if they will go, they will get the justice. So basically the data interpretation needs to be also considered when we need to see data just onto the face value and when we just not to see the data onto the face value. So this basically issue has been provided here that in India, we need to cover the gap onto the data. Number one gap is that we need to do the data validation. Number two, it has been provided that the data interpretation also needed to be carried. So guys, that is all about this particular article. I hope you have understood it. And now we'll be moving to the next article. Now, this particular article, guys, taken up from the Hindu newspaper, and it is talking about the vulture and related issues, and it will be important for the GS paper number 3, Environment, Ecology and Conservation. First of all, why this particular article suddenly had come onto the vulture? Because, guys, International Vulture Awareness Day will be celebrated onto the September 4th. Now, when we talk about the vultures, it has been provided that actually vultures have been given an important place into our scriptures. For example, there was the story of Jatayu that we have into the Ramayana, and Jatayu basically Jatayu resisted the Ravan. Fine. Then guys, there are the basically reference of the Sampati. He was again the vulture and he showed the way towards the Lanka to the Lord Ram. So basically the vultures, they have been given a very important place into our scriptures, particularly into the epic of Ramayana. They have been given an important place. However, today if we see the vultures, they are declining into our ecosystem. And between 1990s and mid 2000, India lost more than 95% of their vulture population. Now, there are first of all some of the basic information with respect to the vulture that has been provided here. Guys, please be very careful onto this particular information because it could be asked as a part of an objective question into the prelims. First of all, when we talk about the vultures, they belong to the accipitridae family. Fine. And into this accipitridae family, apart from the vultures, the eagles are included, hawks are included, and the kites are included. Fine. And basically when we talk about the vultures, they are called as a social birds. Fine. They live into a kind of a colonies, and their average lifespan is 10 to 30 years into the wild. Now the vultures, they have particularly the bulky body structure, and they live onto the tall trees and rocky cliffs because of the heavy body that they are having. Now vultures are particularly the slow breeders. Fine. They don't breed too much, and because of that, even if there is a little bit decline into the vulture population, that will not be replenished into the coming years because of their slow breeding behavior. So every individual survival is very much crucial. Then next, it has been provided that the vultures, they have excellent eyesight, a strong sense of smell, and because of the strong sense of smell, the vultures can detect the presence of dead animals from the great distances, and they can go and they can feast onto those dead animals. Now, vultures, they don't have a voice box, and therefore they cannot sing, or they cannot produce the distinct sounds that the other birds can produce. Fine, they communicate via the grunts and the hisses. Now, when we talk about the vultures, actually, they rely on to the other carnivores to open the carcasses. They cannot directly open a carcass. Rather, when another animals, they have opened up the carcass, they will go and they feed on it because of their distinct beaks that they are having. After, when we talk about the vultures, guys, it has been provided that they are the natural scavengers of the ecosystem. Why they are the natural scavengers? See, when there is a dead animal. Now, this dead animal will become host to many of the pathogens. It will become the host to many of the disease. If a dog eats this particular carcass, then the dog cannot ingest all the pathogens that were there, and this particular dog will become the carrier of that particular disease and will spread the disease to the other people. Into the same way, many of the animals, they cannot ingest. Though they might eat the carcass, but they cannot ingest the pathogens. However, vultures, they have a highly acidic stomach, and because of this highly acidic stomach, they can digest the rotting carcass and kill the disease causing bacteria. So actually they clean the earth. They are not the carriers of the disease which other animal can become. But now what has happened, this particular advantage or benefit of the vultures have not been recognized and their population is declining. What are the reasons for the decline into their population? Number one reason is that basically the use of drug diclofenac had led to their substantial decline into the population. Now the diclofenac, it is a painkiller drug, and many a times it has been used onto the cattle because of many of the disease. And when it is given to the cattle, and suppose that particular cattle dies after getting administered by the diclofenac, then whenever that vulture will eat that particular carcass of that particular cattle, the diclofenac drug will go to the vulture, and the vulture, they cannot digest this diclofenac. And even if a small quantity of the diclofenac is taken by the vulture, then it causes the kidney failure and the death of the vulture. And as the vulture are the slow breeder, already we have seen much of the population has declined. Then guys, it has been provided that often the vultures are misunderstood as a source of disease because they are feasting onto the carcass, and therefore they are deliberately avoided also by the people. Then third, it has been provided that there are the myth also. See, at one time they are being avoided because they carry disease, but at the second time there are myth are there that they have the medicinal healing power, and because of that vultures are being hunted, their specific body parts for they are sold, and therefore the vultures are being hunted, and because of that also their population has declined. Then next, fourth reason is that basically the vultures, many of their traditional habitats, into them the quarrying, blasting of stones, etc. is going on, and guys, their habitats have declined considerably because the quarrying, blasting, the basically urbanization and all such kind of things. Now therefore it has been said that there are certain steps that has been taken by the government of India in order to conserve the vulture population. What are the steps? Number one, India had banned the diclofenac drug for the veterinary use in 2006, so that the cattle are not administered by the diclofenac and the vultures will not also get it when these cattle will die. Second, what has happened, guys, the five of the states, they have established the vulture breeding center under the action plan for vulture conservation 2020-2025. So guys, vulture conservation plan 2020-2025 was announced recently by the government, and under this the five vulture breeding centers will be into the five states the vulture breeding centers will be created. Then further, it has been provided that though these are the good things, but some things have also been missed. For example, there are no rescue centers for treating the vultures. Okay, if some vulture have been injured, or if they are facing some kind of problem because of consuming the diclofenac, because guys, if I tell you, though onto the veterinary purpose it has been banned in 2006, but still it is sold into a kind of an unregulated way. So if some still eat, for them the rescue centers are not there. Then basically there are the vulture restaurants also, guys. They are existing in many of the countries. What are these vulture restaurants? Basically these are the designated sites where people dispose the carcass of the animal which have been declared as diclofenac free. They are just dumped here and the vultures will be coming and they will be eating these carcass. So these are the vulture restaurants. Now in many of the countries, these vulture restaurants, they have been promoted and actually they have revived the population of the vultures. Now in India, the vulture restaurants have been created in some of the states, in some of the districts, but actually onto a large scale it has not been rolled up. So such vulture restaurant also needs to be scaled up into the country. So guys, these are the issues with respect to the vulture population, the issues related to them, etc. Fine, I hope that you have understood it. And on to the International Vulture Awareness Day, this particular thing has been there, which becomes important. So that is all about this particular article, guys, and now we'll be moving to the next article. Now this particular article, guys, has the first past the post system polarized Indian politics, taken up from the Hindu newspaper, and some of the issues will be important for our GS paper number 2 under the issue related to the politics. However, if I tell you guys, much of this particular article is focused onto the politics that is being carried by the BJP and the opposition parties, etc. Much of the references with respect to the BJP's politics has been given. Fine, you don't need to go too much into the political trends, because guys, going too much into that thing doesn't stay relevant for our UPSC examination. First of all, what do we understand by the FPTP, that is first past the post system?
No, guys, the first past the post system is the system of elections that is followed into the India and into the first past the post system. Any political party which is having the largest number of vote share, it will be winning a particular seat. Let's just understand this particular by the help of an example. Suppose there is a constituency and the name of the constituency is ABC. Now, into this constituency, let's suppose the four political parties are contesting the election. Political party A, political party B, political party C, and D. Now, the political party A, it got, for example, let's say the 30% of the votes. Political party B got the 20% of the votes. Political party C again got the 25% of the vote. And political party D got the 25% of the votes. Fine. So, these are the different political parties which are getting the votes. Now, guys, the political party A, it got the 30% of the vote, and this entire constituency will be won by the political party A. Now, you need to see here that it is not enjoying the majority of basically, it is not enjoying the majority confidence in the constituency. It has not even gained the 50% of the vote. Even half of the people have not supported this political party, but still, this political party got the entire constituency. So, into the first past the post system, whatever party is getting the largest number of votes will win. Fine, it doesn't matter whether minimum 50% of the votes they have got or not. Now, it has been said that India is following this first past the post system, and because of this particular thing, the Indian politics has seen some kind of trends. Number one trend, guys, it has been seen that first of all, what has happened, the political parties which are getting even 30 to 35% of the vote share, they are making their majority government. Into this particular thing, guys, here we can see that the basic rule of democracy has not applied. The democracy is based onto one premise that the government will be based onto the will of the people. But when just you are getting the 30 to 35% of the vote, whether the will of the people has been endorsed? No, it has not been endorsed. So this is the issue number one that comes here. Now, guys, number two, it has been said here that even the political parties who are getting some of the share, like if a political party, here you can see that these C and D political parties got the 25% of the shares, but nothing was given to them. So basically, into the first past the polls post system, what happens? Some political parties, they get disproportionate advantage. Even when they are getting 30 to 35% of the vote, they are making the entire government. And some of the political parties, they got the disproportionate disadvantage. Even when they are getting some considerable vote share, they are not able to form the government. So this is the first past the post system that has been there into the India, and it has been criticized. Now, into the article, guys, there has also been provided that there could be two types of parties. One could be the hegemonic political parties, another could be the electorally dominant political parties. Now, what are the electorally dominated and what are the hegemonic? I will explain the difference. If you see the Congress. Now, the Congress was a hegemonic party into the 1950s and 1960s. It was having the entire hegemony. Now, why it was having the hegemony? Because, guys, the credential of the Congress in 1950s and 60s were very much robust. Why? Because the leaders such as the Jawaharlal Nehru, the Gandhi family, they have participated into basically. They have participated into the freedom struggle, and they being the members of the Congress, the credentials of the Congress were improved, and Congress was a type of a hegemonic party. And this hegemonic party also became the electorally dominated party for next 30 years from 1950s. Now, when we talk about the present government, present BJP, BJP is a electorally dominant party because, guys, it is getting the majorities in 2014 and 2019, but it is not a hegemonic party. The credentials have still to be established. So I hope you understood the difference between hegemonic and electorally dominant. Now, a hegemonic party could be electorally dominant, but electorally dominant party will not be always hegemonic. The difference is that the hegemonic party is one who had developed very robust credentials into the people. Fine, and therefore they are enjoying the majority. But the electorally dominant is that, okay, they got much large number of vote share, they might got large number of seats, but still they have not created hegemony. Still they can be challenged into the near short term. It guys, many times you might be hearing that the BJP might be getting a challenge from a united front. Now, what is united front? United Front is an organ, basically a consolidation that all the opposition parties, they are coming together to fight against the BJP and they are creating an opposition front. So it has been said that in 2024, a United Front will be created and it might, the BJP might face a challenge. So it shows that it is still not a hegemonic party. Now, guys, into this particular article, one particular law has been explained, and this particular law is the Diverger's Law. Now, the Diverger's Law, it has been taken by the name of Maurice Diverger, a French political scientist. Now, the Diverger, under the Diverger Law, provided that into the first past the poll system, as we are following into the India, there a two-party system, basically what happens in mean course of time, a two-party system develops. Now, what is this two-party system? One will be the dominant party at the ruling and the other will be the opposition party that will be created. Apart from that, the other political parties are not that much relevant. It has been seen, for example, if we see post 1990s particularly, there were three kinds of bipolarity that existed. See, in some states, there was the Congress versus BJP. In other states, there was the Congress versus left. In some other states, there was the Congress versus the regional party. Now, the BJP is also doing this thing. Somewhere it is BJP versus Congress. Somewhere it is BJP versus regional party. So, guys, actually, the bipolarity has been created by the first past the post system. So, basically, the first past the post system, it doesn't, basically, when we talk about the multi-party system, which is actually followed into a country, the multi-party system in totality is not followed when you also come with the first past the post system, right? So this is the thing which has been provided into this particular article. Second, it has been said that the first past the post system, it also brings a kind of a polar, it also makes the politics polarized. Why? Because some of the political parties, they are putting forward agenda of a particular class only. Now, guys, we will be taking a crude example here. Don't use it. For example, there is a particular political party, ABC. And this political party says that the OBCs are our vote bank and they are just talking about the OBCs. Now, let's say that into a particular state where this ABC political party is contesting, into that the OBC population is 35%. Now, if this ABC party just leverage their OBC, which are 35%, and if all these OBCs vote into the favor of it, then guys, still the ABC party can form the government here, because the 35% of vote share, if they will get, it is a very big vote share. So basically all the political parties, they have just picked up their client base. Some have picked up OBC, some have picked up in terms of religion, somebody have picked up the Dalits, etc., and they are carrying the polarization. However, it is said that it is not actually the case that only the first past the post system creates polarization. Many times the polarization is created in some other systems also, even into the proportional representation system, which is followed into many of the European countries. There also the polarization has happened. So this is actually a kind of an insensitivity onto the part of political parties, which brings such kind of polarization. Then, guys, the next thing, it has been said that if we see today, into the Indian politics, one more scenario is emerging, that the ruling government is not listening to the opposition parties. And this thing has been said that it is an attitudinal problem that has come into the politics. And this attitudinal problem started from the time of emergency when the opposition parties were sidelined. So that is all, guys, the all trends and patterns that have been talked into this particular article. Apart from this, the political references, the BJP vote bank, etc., has been talked about, not at all important for our examination. So guys, that is all about the idea that has been taken up, and now we'll be moving to the next article. Now guys, this particular article, it is talking about the national monetization pipeline that has been announced by the government recently. Now, into this particular article, that thing has been provided, but guys, already this entire issue of the national monetization pipeline, we have discussed on 24th of August newspaper analysis at this timestamp, that is a 16 minutes 35 seconds. So if you have not seen it, just go and see it. Guys, you don't need to go into the different details which are coming every day, because all things have been covered once and all onto the 24th August newspaper analysis. Now, this particular article, basically, it is questioning that whether the national monetization pipeline by which government aims to bring 6 lakh crore rupees will be successful or not, because already government had come out many a times with the disinvestment policy. Even for this particular year, the disinvestment plan was there, that 1.75 lakh crore rupees will be mobilized, but guys, no disinvestment has happened. So whether it will be successful, it is a question of matter. Moreover, it has been said that there are many of the modalities that are needed to be finalized, because onto the long term basis, the contracts will be signed under the national monetization pipeline. So onto that also there might be the problems that might come. Moreover, guys, it has been said that under the national monetization pipeline, we will be coming with the PPP, that is the public-private partnership model. But it was suggested in 2014 that an apex body needs to be created over the PPPs, but such kind of body has not been created up till now. So such kind of body, which is not there onto the PPP, might also bring the problem that if into the future disputes are there, how they will be resolved. So guys, these are some of the issues which are there, but already we have discussed them also into the 24 August newspaper analysis. So you can see that also. Fine, apart from this, nothing there is there. So that is all. Now we'll be moving to the next article. Now, this particular article, guys, it is talking about the new drone rules that have been initiated for the startups as well as from the other small and medium enterprises. Now, what has happened? Guys, the Civil Aviation Ministry has notified the drone rules 2021. It has been said that these drone rules will facilitate the startups, the drone taxis into the India, and the drone industry will be promoted by these drone rules. Now, what are these provisions? First of all, we will be seeing these provisions one by one. Number one provision is that basically the unmanned aircraft system, fine, their weight has been increased. Earlier, 300 kg was the maximum weight for the UAVs, unmanned aircraft systems. Now it has been increased to 500 kgs. Now, how this will be helping? Guys, we are proposing the drone taxis. The drone taxis where you can use and you can go to the different places. But for the drone taxis, the weight limit of earlier 300 kg was very much less. Now it has been increased to 500 kg. So it will be a positive development. And therefore, the drone taxis might now be coming into the India. Then the next thing is that the drone corridors will be developed for delivering the cargoes. Now you are getting the Amazon package from a physical delivery person. In future, they might come via drone, and the drone corridors have been cleared. Fine, they will deliver your cargoes. Then next, it has been provided that an unmanned aircraft system promotion council will be established. This will be a body that will facilitate the business friendly regulatory regime. Now guys, we also want to be an exporting nation and we want to develop the drones. So basically the business friendly environment for the drone production, drone regularization is also to be provided. Into that thing, this aircraft system promotion council will be helping out. The next thing it has been provided that the liberalization is also basically carried into the drone industry. No security clearances will be required before any registration or license issue of drones. You just be getting the licenses, security clearances are not needed. Then next, it has been provided that the number of forms or the permission that are oftenly used for that is to be used for the drone operation, it has been reduced from 25 to just 5. Then next, it has been provided that the pilot license will not be required for the operating of the nano drones and micro drones for the non-commercial use. So if you want to operate a particular drone for photography, etc., you will not be required a commercial pilot license. Then after that, it has been provided that type certificate, unique identification number, prior permission, remote pilot license will not be needed for the research and development entities also. So guys, much of the licensing requirement are being reduced. You can see here. Then it has been provided that for the import of the drone also, some of the regularizations have been made, and the import of drones will be regulated by the Directorate General of Foreign Trade, that is the DGFT. Then ninthly, it has been provided that there will be no restriction onto the foreign ownership into the Indian drone companies. Fine. Then the online registration of all the drones will happen onto the Digital Sky platform. So it will be a website where you can go and register your drone. And then finally, it has been provided that an interactive airspace map will be developed onto this Digital Sky platform, and this interactive map will divide the region into the red zone, yellow zone, and the green zone. Now into the green zone, you can operate the drone without any permission. Yellow zone, you can operate the drone with the permission, and into the red zone, the drone cannot be operated. And the red zone, guys, will be the area which are very much near to the airports, the area which are important for the security and all such kind of thing. So guys, these are the drone rules that had come, and they will be helping in order to make the drone industry into the India more vibrant. And guys, drone taxis, such kind of enterprises can also open up. So that is all about this particular article. And now guys, we'll be moving to the next article. Now
This particular article, guys, taken up from the Hindu newspaper, and it is just talking about one particular issue that has been taken up into the Supreme Court. Now, the Supreme Court had said that we will hear a petition that has been made into the Supreme Court with respect to imposing a life ban onto the convicted MPs and MLAs, the MPs who have been convicted of a crime. Now, if we see, presently, guys, if any particular MP or MLA is convicted of the crime, he is banned from the election for the 6 years. It is being said that if you are convicting any particular bureaucrat of corruption, you remove him from job. So he is banned from the job for entire life. Now, if an MLA or MP is convicted of crime, why just 6 years ban on him is there? Rather, they are needed to be banned for the entire life. Into this particular direction, a petition was made into the Supreme Court, and now the Supreme Court had said that okay, we will hear this particular petition onto the length, and we will decide that whether such kind of thing can be there or not. Moreover, guys, the Chief Justice of India had also provided that there are some other measures also which can be introduced in order to remove the criminalization of politics. It has been said that we needed to establish more special Central Bureau of Investigation courts, CBI courts, into the places where the MPs and MLAs are being tried. Many a times, guys, there are MPs and MLAs which are facing the trial, but there is only one special court. And because of that, often the delays are there in dispensing the matters related to the MPs and MLAs where they have done the crime. So therefore, in order to ensure the accessibility as well as to decongest the existing CBI courts, we needed to establish more CBI courts which can take up the cases of MPs and MLAs for their crimes. Then next, it has been provided that, guys, when we see, there are large number of sitting MPs and MLAs who are facing the criminal charges. For example, 121 cases are there against sitting and former MPs. They are pending into the trial, whereas there are 112 CBI cases against the MLAs which are pending. So such large number of cases are pending against the MPs and MLAs, and into this particular direction, number one, they are to be cleared into a fast manner. Number two, it is also needed to be explored that whether they can be banned for the entire life. Now, on to the first thing, already the Chief Justice of India as well as Supreme Court had given a direction that wherever the case for the MPs and MLAs are there, we needed to constitute a special court. The second thing is about banning them for the entire life. So on to this thing, the consideration will be made now. That is all, guys, about this particular article. With respect to the criminalization of politics, you can refer this particular step. So that is important for our GS paper number 2. And now, guys, we will be moving to the next article. Now, this particular article, guys, talk about a formal MOU that has been signed between the Indian firm and the Maldives to develop a project into the Maldives, that is the Greater Malé Connectivity Project. Now, guys, this Greater Malé Connectivity Project is a big infrastructural project that is being sponsored by India within the Maldives. Now, this Greater Malé Connectivity Project, it is a 6.74 kilometer long bridge and a link between the Malé and the nearby island. Which island it will be connecting? It will be connecting the Malé with the islands of Vilinjali, Bulifalu, and Hilafushi. So basically, these are the three islands which will be connected with the Malé by this particular Greater Malé Connectivity Project. Now, guys, into this particular direction, the Indian construction company, that is the EFCONS, he have been given the project. Now, when we talk about this Greater Malé Connectivity Project, why we are saying that India is sponsoring it? Because, guys, this particular project is being funded by a grant of $100 million as well as a line of credit of $400 million from India. So it is a $500 million project. $100 million we are giving as a grant, and $400 million we are giving as a line of credit. Now, into this particular direction, guys, when we talk about the Greater Malé Connectivity Project, it is again very much important because, guys, India is creating it to counter the Sinamale Bridge. Now, the Sinamale Bridge is the Chinese project into the Maldives. And by this Sinamale Bridge, they are connecting the Malé with the Hulu Malé and Hulhule. Fine. So basically, China took it up and completed it in 2018. And guys, we saw it is an attempt of Chinese debt trap diplomacy that they have taken up into the Maldives. And by such kind of things, the Maldives might have become more inclined towards the China. So as a response, we also initiated a project into the Maldives, that is the Greater Malé Connectivity Project. And now the tender has been given to a developer and it will now be started up. And guys, as it is a very big
point in scale compared with the Sinhamale Bridge of the China, India will be getting upper hand into the Maldives. So guys, that is all. And guys, with respect to the India's neighborhood policy, such kind of things becomes very much important, because into the neighborhood first policy, we always say that we are working on building the capacity of the our neighboring countries. So in that direction, it becomes an important thing. So guys, that is all about the today's newspaper analysis. With this, we come to an end for today's discussion. Guys, I hope that you have liked it. And guys, please do keep supporting us. Please do hit the like button. Please do spread our initiative. So that is all for today. We will be meeting up tomorrow. Thank you so much.